notice the way that some of these guys are kind of conversing through their instruments. This is a song called Recording. Thank you. So, let's hear, let's hear from two or three of you. Just put your hand up in the air. One thing that you noticed that in the middle of the performance, something that you noticed about the way the guys are playing with each other. The wrong answers. Yes, ma'am. Speak up a little.
There was a lot of emotion within the music, and it transmitted it to the audience.
Okay. Cool. Other one. Not sure exactly if they were all good emotions. Right. What else? How about another one? Great observation. Yes, sir. Alex. Right. Did you notice that? Now, that's actually a good point, Alex. Did you notice how, especially Daniel and Richard, would change things, and Colin too, for that matter, but especially Daniel, remember you and I were talking this morning about how the drum set drives the band in a lot of ways, right? Did you notice how he drove the bus differently?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
That's why we all want to hire this guy, because he just makes everybody sound good, no matter what we're doing. That's not good. Okay. Have another one more. Good observation. Yes, sir.
You're making lots of eye contact.
We're making lots of eye contact. You're communicating, right? And we weren't chattering. The only somewhat verbal communication is when we held this up. Anyone know what this means? Straightforward. Very good. Okay. So we want to talk a little bit about that communication, right? So there were probably what, maybe 100,000 details that we negotiated with in that song. Throughout the course of the song, there were probably 100,000 decisions that were made that were based on what was happening with each other. So Joey plays a specific note, Colin makes a change to his voicing, and it's... Right? Yeah, he did something and then Colin copied his shape and helped the shape sound better. So there were like thousands, literally thousands of those decisions made. So this, when we break it down to slow motion, how do you get really good at making those decisions? Well, one of the biggest parts of jazz is a thing that many of you have heard, probably heard of, it's called call and response, right? Everybody heard of call and response? You do that, anybody do that in your jazz groups or your jazz classes? You've done it, you just don't know it's called that, I promise you. Okay, so what we're gonna do is I'm gonna have each of the guys in the band here talk a little bit about how they respond to whatever they're hearing in the moment, how their instrument and how they do personally as well. So I'm gonna start with Paul.
Hey guys, so yeah, over here on the piano, I guess a big part of what I'm trying to do is just bridge the gap. I mean, as far as a small combo goes, bridge the gap between the rhythm of the band, the melody that these guys are playing, since they're pretty much single notes, they can outline chords and harmony, but I kind of have a lot of control over how the rhythm and the harmony and melody kind of come together. I mean, and in a lot of ways, like a pianist can really dictate exactly what's going on. You know, you can just play very straight up chords. Or you can choose to like wait and take like a rhythmic thing, like Daniel was doing this thing on the drums, like buffalo, boom. So there's a few times where I was like trying to come back to that rhythmic theme. Stretch things around, like take the fifth of a major chord and like bridge it up to the sixth. So I'm taking little rhythm cues and melodic cues from these guys and taking the chords of the song and trying to sort of give support to each of the guys, you know, like if Joey has an idea, he wants to take it this way, it's like, how do I in the moment take it and like help him make that like almost as if there's like a reason and a logic behind what he did, even though he just improvised and pulling it out. It's like, how do I make that justified by like calling, by responding to what he's doing and adding that little then again, a different scale chord, you know? Like, I'm taking that theme that he did and I'm repeating it so that there's these, like, common threads and little themes that happen over and over again. So I'm trying to respond to what these guys are doing. Like John said, you know, I've probably made 5,000 decisions based on what the bass player is doing, the drummer is doing, just hitting different rhythms and harmonies and melodies, and maybe trying to take one of their ideas and put it in my solo. So I'm really just trying to bridge the gap in a lot of ways as a pianist. And just responding to what they're doing, you know?
Hey everybody, how you doing? So for me personally, I know Daniel and Colin really well, and I just finally met you for the first time today, and kind of enjoyed it for a little while. But there's a lot of trust involved in this music, and since I know these two rhythm section players really well, I trust them. I trust them a lot. So what I try to do, I guess on the side of call and response, just as a general rule, it's great when you're younger to kind of imitate exactly what other people are doing. But the older you get, the less cool that is. I think it's better to compliment, use call and response as a way to compliment. You can show someone that you heard what they were doing without playing exactly what they played. And you can do that. You used it as a comic figure to compliment what he did. You didn't just play exactly what he played. There's a big difference. You can step on somebody's toes and really get in their way when you do that. So I think that's a great way to learn, is to imitate exactly what people do, but as you get older, try and create your own ways to show them that you heard what they did, and to lift them up and make them sound better. As far as a comic instrument and the decisions that I'm making, along with that trust, is I kind of know when is my time to kind of shine through a little bit in the holes in their comment. I go and I call him and play something, and I kind of tell, okay, well, he might go this direction, so I think it's safe for me to maybe go in my higher register or try and stay down low so that I'm complimenting what he's doing. Same with Daniel, like, he's going to leave space here is my guess, and then I know whether I can play more notes or less notes. But the same goes with Joey. He was soloing, and I think his second or third chorus, he was doing a lot of eighth notes, and then the chorus after that turned to 16th notes, and then we kind of got in this loose vibe where he was playing longer open tones, and I was able to kind of up the neck and play more than one note at once, kind of create a nice layer for him to continue building that energy off of less notes but more energy somehow. So it's kind of cool, it's a tension release sort of vibe, and that is its own type of call and response. It's more of a, yeah. So that's about what I have to say, I think. So.
Hey, everyone. So, Richard mentioned this word energy, and with call and response, what's really interesting about it is it doesn't necessarily mean somebody plays something and then when they're done playing something, you play something else. It doesn't necessarily mean that, especially being a rhythm section player. A lot of what we do when soloists are playing is we're being supportive, right? That's the whole thing. If I was just going and just playing on my licks and playing super loud, like, look at me, I'm not being supportive, right? So being that as a drummer, what we focus on, as opposed to like rhythm, like we think rhythmic call and response, so. Mr. Vander plays rhythm and then we play a similar rhythm to complete a phrase. Or maybe one of these guys, or calling whoever's soloing, is maybe playing a lot of notes at the end of the phrase. Did you guys feel that in that tune? Like there was a point where maybe Mr. Joey here was like really just like ripping at the end of the phrase and we kind of stirred it up and it kind of just went crazy on big beat one at the beginning of the tune. Feel that at all, maybe? So that's the kind of, you know, another part of call and response is like call and response in terms of energy, creating this momentum to help propel things forward. Because in this music, things always have to push forward. Okay, it's kind of like if you've asked yourself, like, you know, is the hi-hat, do we play the hi-hat on 1 and 3 or 2 and 4? Which one? 2 and 4? Have you ever thought about why we do that? Have you ever thought about that? And I'm not like, you know, how many drummers are here? I'm not just talking to the drummers here. I'm talking about everybody. When you hear this, is that on 1 and 3 or is that on 2 and 4? This is 1 and 3? You sure?
1, 2, 3.
So if I'm counting off a swing tune and I go 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4. You think I'm snapping 1 and 3? What if I did this? 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4. Which one had better like dancing kind of quality? The second one, right? Okay? And did I do any? Did I like slow down on the first one? No. I didn't. I was snapping right in time. Does that make sense? So like jazz music and all this has this sense of forward momentum. The hi-hat's on 2 and 4 because those are essentially the weak beats. And that's driving the bus. That's getting us to beat 1 of every beat. Does that make sense? That's why the hi-hat's on 2 and 4. And so to complement this thing about energy, creating this energy and this sense of momentum via column response, they're playing a bunch of stuff, and we're rhythmically keeping this forward momentum going to help support the soloist. Does that make sense? Just another little part, just about call and response, where it doesn't have to necessarily be when somebody has played something and then you play something. It is like when they're playing something, you're like lifting them higher. That makes sense?
Yeah. It's, for me, it's really interesting to hear a rhythm section perspective on all of this stuff as a horn player, because more often than not, my mind's in an entirely different place. But this call and response thing, it's a two-way street, you know. So sometimes, more often than not, as a soloist, I feel like the rhythm section is reacting or responding to what I'm playing, and that's, you know, absolutely the way it should be. But let me ask you this, and you can raise your hands if you want, or this could be a rhetorical question. How many times have you played a solo and thought to yourself, I'm coming up empty? I mean, has that happened to anybody here other than me? Because that happens to me, man. After all of these years, sometimes I'm just thinking to myself, I'm coming up empty. And I might feed off of something I hear the rhythm section do. And it might be just this rhythmic thing that Colin's comping, or it might just be the way Daniel's peppering his snare drum. But absolutely, you better believe that I'm mining the rhythm section for information as well. So, and you know, this whole idea of call and response, oftentimes I think, there's call and response in its truest form, which you see in a lot of rhythm and blues and a lot of old blues, where you really are just sort of repeating information. And there's a certain amount of validation involved in repeating information. If you play a lick as a horn player in a solo and you play it again, in some respects it validates what you played the first time. But oftentimes, the dialogue that I experience with the rhythm section, I think more like action and reaction, or cause and effect, you know, that kind of call and response. Anyway, yeah.
Okay, so you guys see, call and response isn't just play the song back or play the melody back or the little fragment that you heard back. Everybody responds in different ways, and I love the way that Joey said it, cause and effect. And as you become stronger and stronger musicians, you develop more tools in the way that you can respond to whatever's happening. Get that? Okay, cool. So we want to do some responding to you. We're going to move into, since I know a lot of you have signed up here to do a little playing with a pro group here, we're going to go ahead and honor that and have some of you come up and play. Now, this, everybody has should have a handout on just B-flat blues. And one of the things that we just want to, Joe and I were talking about this morning, one of the things that we firmly want you guys to understand, that was never really explained to us when we were younger jazz musicians, was that every chord that you see, whether it's in a big band chart, in a small group, in your combos at school, whatever you're doing, every chord that you see has some scales, one, at least one, probably more than one scale that can go with it. Okay, have you guys all heard this before? When you work on your stuff? So we're going to go into a B-flat blues here, and I want Joey to demonstrate just a couple of different sounds. Colin's going to play some chords for you, just on B-flat 7. And Joey's going to give you some different sounds. So if you look at your handout, the first scale that's written up at the top of that, you should have it in your key, it's just a B-flat blues scale. So take a listen to this, what this sounds like. nice thing here is that your rhythm section, no matter what note you play, is helping you sound good. That's that call and response that those tools we're talking about, right? So when you come up here, no matter what happens, just have fun. We talked this morning with one of the bands about playing like we were singing in the shower and nobody was listening. Okay, so get up here and just have fun. I think Joey said, have fun in your head and it'll come out of your voice. So, all right, good job. Let's get another round of applause.
Thank you.
Big hand for Katie.
And Taylor, come on, let's go. Good job for the transition. Daniel, take over the drum set. And let's get Axel on flute. Axel on flute. Brianna on alto saxophone. Axel, Brianna. Jorge, Gonzalez.